The Senate will come to order. I ask everyone present to please rise and repeat with me the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Reverend Sonia Chambers, the senior pastor of Standard Bearer Ministries in Rosedale, will deliver today's invocation. Reverend Chambers.
Good morning. Can we bow our heads? Father, we just thank you and we just praise you for this time. Father, we thank you for every legislative body here. Cover each and every person, their families. Bring unity even now in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for covering New York State. We thank you that wisdom is being poured down on each and every man and each and every woman. We thank you that bipartisan lines can be connected. We thank you, oh God, that you're going to do something new in this house. We thank you, oh God, that you're going to do something perfect for your will. I thank you, oh God, that you're taking care of the people and you're taking care of the families. And furthermore, you're taking care of New York. We thank you that you're doing it for your glory. We thank you that you're doing it for your honor. And we thank you that each and every person here will be blessed. I speak a blessing over their lives, even now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
I want to ask that the courtesy of the house be extended to her and her flock. Thank you very much.
Reading of the journal.
In Senate Thursday, March 28, 2019, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Wednesday, March 27, 2019, was read and approved. On motion, Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions, messages from the Assembly, messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports from state officers. Motions and resolutions. Senator Janaris.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Kennedy, on page 20, I offer the following amendments to calendar 347, Senate 3657, ask that said bill retain its place on the third reading calendar.
The amendment is received and the bill shall retain its place on the third reading calendar.
Please call on Senator Griffo.
Senator Griffo.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Boyle, I submit the following, Senate Bill 700, ask that it be discharged from its respective committee and recommitted with instructions to strike the enacting clause.
It is so ordered. Senator Janaris.
I now move to adopt the resolution calendar with the exception of Resolution 853.
All in favor of adopting the resolution calendar with the exception of Resolution 853, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The resolution calendar is adopted. Senator Janaris.
Can we please take up previously adopted Resolution 783 by Senator Harkin, read that resolution in its entirety, and recognize Senator Harkin.
The Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution number 783 by Senator Harkin, recognizing March 29, 2019 as Vietnam Veterans Day. Whereas the state of New York takes great pride in acknowledging days of observance of significant historic events, and whereas March 29, 2019 has been declared Vietnam Veterans Day, and whereas the United States carried out its first combat mission against the Viet Cong on January 12, 1962 in Operation Chopper, United States Army pilots lifted more than 1,000 South Vietnam service members over jungle and underbrush to capture a National Liberation Front stronghold near Saigon. And whereas the last American troops left Vietnam on March 29, 1973, and whereas during the 11-year war, Americans from different backgrounds, races, and creeds banded together to fight against the Viet Cong, and whereas more than 3 million Americans served their country, and more than 58,000 sacrificed their lives, the names of those lost are forever engraved in the Black Granite Vietnam Memorial in Washington, D.C. And whereas the Vietnam War was a tumultuous time in America, when our brave service members returned home, often with physical and emotional scars, the voices of those who opposed the war sadly overcame those who supported our troops. And whereas the state of New York wishes to show its Vietnam veterans the respect and appreciation they deserve, but did not always get when they returned home. Now, therefore, be it resolved that this legislative body pause in its deliberations to recognize March 29th, 2019 at Vietnam Veterans Day, and to thank our brave Vietnam veterans for their honorable service to their country, and be it further resolved that copies of this resolution, suitably engrossed, be transmitted to Vietnam veteran organizations.
Senator Harkin on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. Also want to thank Senator Brooks for co-sponsoring this important resolution. I've spoken on this floor with pride about the service of my father and my grandfather in World War II and World War I. Those who fought in World War II were called the greatest generation, and with good reason. But there was another great generation that didn't always get the accolades that it deserved. And they came from places like Peekskill and Carmel and Patterson and Mount Kisco. And they went to a place called Vietnam because their country asked them to. When they were called to service, they went professionally, they went capably, they fought hard, and they brought honor to themselves and to their country. And yet when they came back, their country did not always recognize the sacrifices and the accomplishments that they made. And thankfully, as time has passed, we've begun to recognize our veterans for their incredible service. But when they came back, they didn't stop serving because they were there for each other. They came back with physical illnesses. They came back with wounds. They came back with psychological scars. And while the rest of society was not necessarily focused on their pain and their plight after their service, they were. And they were there for each other, and they continue to be there for each other. For instance, in things like the Dwyer peer-to-peer program, which I'm proud to say we in a bipartisan fashion have put back in the budget. Just a valuable program of one vet helping another vet. And so today, we gather here in a bipartisan way to honor their service. We have gentlemen here from Westchester and Putnam in my district, but we have Vietnam veterans from all our districts. So today I'm proud to honor Carl Rohde, Arthur Hanley, James McCarthy, John Mastromarino, Jim Martin, Salvatore Bellinconi, Harry Sherbloom, Joseph P. Reynolds, and Frank Guderi. As this legislative body today pauses to honor Vietnam veterans, and we declare this Vietnam Veterans Day. So, Mr. President, I humbly ask that you allow them all the privileges that this chamber affords and all the respect from all of the members of this esteemed body.
Senator Brooks on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. Today is Vietnam Veterans Day. This war and the events that took place during this war changed America. The war began when I was in elementary school. When it was time to go to college, the war was still going on. The war began under President Kennedy by sending some advisors. And over the course of the war, four different presidents would serve as commander in chief during this war. During this time, we would see the assassination of a president of the United States. We'd see the passage of a Civil Rights Act. We'd see President Johnson elect not to seek re-election because of the war. We'd see an assassination of a civil rights leader, Martin Luther King. The assassination of a presidential candidate and a senator of this state, Robert Kennedy. We'd see the election and the resignation of Richard Nixon as president. And we see the installation of Gerald Ford, the first unelected president in our nation's history. The war started with some troops that were in Vietnam to serve as advisors. As the war continued to grow and expand, the support for the war was on decline. Vietnam was the first war that ever came into our living rooms. Every night, we saw that war
on television. We saw the horrors of what war really was. The words and the music of the day reflected the war and the changing attitudes. There was a line in one of the songs, "You're old enough to kill, but not old enough to vote. You don't believe in war, but what's that gun you're toting?" Many felt that our country was on the eve of destruction. Protests across the nation grew. On colleges and universities across the nation, protesters took over campuses. In Ohio, National Guard units that were called to restore order resulted in 4 students being killed. Protests began to focus beyond just the political leaders, and suddenly the members of the service were becoming targets of the protests. Finally, after 11 years, more than 58,000 soldiers being lost, more than 3 million individuals serving, President Ford returned the troops home. But when they came home, they didn't have the welcome that troops normally had. They didn't hear the thank yous that troops normally heard. We're honored today to have veterans of that war. These men, like those who took up arms to free this nation and create this nation, those who took up arms to maintain this as a single nation, those that stormed the beaches on D-Day were all heroes. These men that are here in this room today and all the veterans of Vietnam were heroes, but they'd never received the welcome home they deserved. They were called to service by this nation, and they served admirably. The war was won in which a country became fed up with. But these men did what they were to do. So today, to these men, we say welcome home. We say thank you for your service. May God bless each and every one of you, and may God bless the United States of America. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Mayer, on the resolution.
It's my honor, and I want to thank Senator Harkin and Senator Brooks for bringing this resolution to the floor today. But this really is a day to honor you individually, as individuals who really stepped up in a time of great conflict, went and served our country, and came home in a time of great conflict where you were not acknowledged and recognized and thanked. And today is another opportunity for us to say, we made a mistake when you came home. Today we thank you in an official way on behalf of the people of the state of New York. So many of you came back to your communities and jumped in and joined groups and participated and became active members of your community, and we're so appreciative. But others of your colleagues came home and were unable to do that and had a lasting pain, and really the challenges of serving in Vietnam had an impact on their lives forever. So we have an obligation as members of this body and as members of this country, one, to celebrate and honor your contribution, to thank you, and to make a lasting promise to those who could not make it when they came back, that we owe it to them to give them everything they need in order to survive and thrive. Today is a day for you. We honor you. We appreciate your being here. I know several of you are from my district, but throughout New York State, from villages and towns, from cities alike, people stepped up and went You are among them. We honor you, and we appreciate your being here today. Thank you very much.
Senator Sanders on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to thank Senator Harkin and Senator Brooks for this. I want to also thank all of the vets and to the Marines among you, I say Semper Fi. Only one. We got to work on that. That's all right. I was trained by many of this generation. I'm post-Vietnam. I was trained by many of this generation, and I can attest that it was some tough training that you guys had. You were very serious in it. I also want to applaud the raw courage that it took to do your duty, to get out there and to just go from one world to another world to, you know, ours was not to question why. We were just sent there, and whatever we did, that the raw courage. I also want to say that in this country, there is room for dissent. That's part of the reason why we fought. We wanted to make sure that there could be room for dissent. But I encourage people who want to dissent, take it up with the politicians who send folk to these places. Take it up with those guys. Don't take it up with the troops. The troops, we just do whatever we're ordered to do. We just go wherever the government says it that we should go. So I encourage people who have dissent to this day or other days, take it up with whoever is sending the troops. And I encourage us in this country that we seem to love the troops, but we really forget the veterans when they get back. We really kind of, they're on their own out here. And well, we could do something as we have. Now, to this body is better than most, and I applaud that on both sides of the aisle, that when it comes to veterans, we are pretty good in making sure that all of the needs that we can think of are met. So I applaud all of us, but I encourage the rest of the nation that let's not forget that troops, God willing, become veterans, and they have needs and scars and things that they want to contribute. So I applaud you all. I again applaud those of us who have served, and I applaud Senator Harkin and Senator Brooks for bringing us here together and simplify again.
Senator Robach on the resolution.
Yes, Mr. President. Let me rise to support this important resolution. I think anytime we can applaud, say thank you, and recognize our veterans, it's not only necessary, but critically important. And I want to especially thank those Vietnam veterans who today we honor, who are here in the chamber, and not only them, but Vietnam veterans all across our state. And I am always so proud to work with Chapter 20 out of Monroe County, our Vietnam Veterans Chapter, which in addition, I thank them for their service, but have been so active in creating a veterans court, working on programs for homeless veterans, PTSD, and lately taking up the mantle on the terrible scourge we have where 22 veterans a day of all wars are committing suicide. So I thank you for what your past service has been, your men and women of your era, and also what you continue to do today on behalf of veterans. It's critically important, and I want you to know your efforts, we just don't thank you, are inspiring to me to make sure that we put the resources to help you do the important job you do to take care of the veterans. Or as my colleague Senator Sanders said, sometimes we have to put our actions with our words, but we thank you. And I'll end on a very positive note. Even though I think we got the whole Vietnam thing wrong in terms of veterans returning, I'm always so pleased whenever I'm in a parade for any reason and the Chapter 20 Honor Guard goes by, Vietnam veterans, and the crowd claps for them the loudest because they know we didn't get it right the first time. But I'm glad we're getting it now, and we thank you and all your colleagues for what you've done and what you continue to do. God bless you, and know it's greatly appreciated, and we're going to make sure that future generations appreciate that also. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Serino on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's so nice to see Carl and Art and the other Vietnam veterans here today. I thank you for coming. You know, a lot of us here remember Colonel Larkin, right? And every time he would get up and he'd speak so passionately and tell us his stories, and he'd have tears in his eyes. And I made a promise to him to always remind people about the Honor Flight. And I think, Carl and Art, you can appreciate this, because just a couple of years ago, they opened the Honor Flight to the Vietnam veterans. And there wasn't a dry eye in the airport. And I try to make it to every single one. And I think it's been such a long time for you guys to hear the thank you. And when you see that at the airport and the people that come out, I think it's very important for you guys to know that you have this community behind you. And we thank you, and God bless all of you for being here today, and God bless you for your service. Thank you.
Senator Helming on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise in support of this resolution. To our Vietnam veterans who are here today, I honestly had no intention of rising to speak on this resolution. My intention was to come over, shake your hand, and sincerely thank you for your service to this great country of ours, and to also apologize for the way you are treated. I find myself very, very conflicted about a couple of things. One, we talk a lot about making sure that we continue to honor our veterans, that we do everything that we can to make up for the horrendous treatment that you experienced as Vietnam veterans. And I am thrilled today to hear from one of my colleagues that the funding has been restored for the Dwyer program. But in my area that I represent, the Dwyer program doesn't cover most of the area. What does cover it is a program called the Warrior Salute Program. It provides comprehensive services for veterans who are experiencing PTSD, for veterans who are homeless. It's a tremendous service. And this body in the One House budget cut the $200,000 that program received from the state Senate year after year. To me, I think we could do better. So many of the people, the recipients of the Warrior Salute Program, are Vietnam veterans. We can do better. We can show that we stand for these veterans, that we're not just paying lip service in this body, that we're doing everything we can. So it's my hope, my desperate hope, that that program is restored. I want to tell you that I'm being a little bit selfish when I speak to you too. My son-in-law right now, he's a proud member of the U.S. Special Forces. He's on a mission. So I want these services for the people who are veterans. You need them. I also want to keep them intact for our men and women who are currently out there fighting. Oftentimes we forget that we're still a nation at war, that there are women and men who are sacrificing their lives every single day. I also want to bring up something else that I heard recently that I've been trying to ignore, but it's time to speak out about it. I represent an area of the Finger Lakes. Seneca Falls, the birthplace of women's rights, is located in my district. And in Seneca Falls is a National Women's Hall of Fame. I don't know if you gentlemen have heard. I don't know if my colleagues have heard. But the Women's Hall of Fame has recently announced that they are going to be inducting into the Hall of Fame Jane Fonda. I guess there's not too much I want to say about that. But I want to offer to you, if you have thoughts on that, if you have opinions on that, please let me know. Because you can believe that I will be standing up for our Vietnam veterans and will be adamantly opposed to that. And I will carry your voices if you'd like me to. Thank you, Mr. President. I proudly stand in support of this resolution, in support of our Vietnam veterans.
Senator Bailey on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I align myself with the comments of all of my colleagues today. It is a great day in this House when we can say that we are all on one accord. We should be able to say that far more often, I believe. Senator Harkin and Senator Brooks, thank you for bringing this resolution to the floor, and to the brave veterans, thank you for doing something that I could not imagine doing. You see, I recognize my privileges in society. I recognize that I have things that other people don't have. I have abilities that are afforded to me because of folks like you. Because of folks like you that did things that you may or may not have wanted to do, but were compelled to do for the betterment of your country, for our country. And despite what you may think, you make America great. You made America great by your sacrifices. You see, people like me, I'm 36 years old. I've learned about the Vietnam War only through recollections of others, only through pop culture, only through movies like Dead Presidents, where you see the disparity and the despair in Vietnam vets who come home and can't find work. And you hear the songs like War by Edwin Starr, who say, what is war? What is it good for? It absolutely nothing. And when you think about people like you who fought for me, I couldn't not stand up. Because I've fought for things, but I've never had to fight. You had to do it. And you put the American flag, literally and figuratively, on your backs. And anytime I've spoken to a vet from Vietnam, they can recall with crystal clear specificity about their service, about what they did, about who they lost, and where they were and what time it happened. I can't imagine having to remember things that you remember for the sake of people that you've never even met. And I dare say, Mr. President, the true test of leadership in this House, for members and non-members, for anybody within the sound of my voice, is to think about what you're doing for people that you'll never meet. That's leadership. That's bravery. I salute you today and any other day. God bless you. God bless your service. And I strongly support this resolution, Mr. President.
Senator Comrie on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to echo the comments of my colleagues and thank the veterans for being here today. I hope that your entire day here in Albany is enjoyable. I want to thank them for their service. As Senator Bailey said, it's a commitment that they have to show that they're true Americans, that they truly cared about this country. They went to serve because they had to. It was before the draft ended, so they didn't have a choice. But they wanted to serve our country. They wanted to make sure that we had a better life for all of us, so that we could be here today, so that America could be the country that it truly aspires to be, a country that serves all, that works for all, and that embraces all. So I just want to thank them for their service. I can't speak to, I would speak to the to many things about this, because when I finished high school, the draft ended. And I was so happy that the draft ended, because I was a big chicken. I was worried about going. And I was worried about having to serve. I saw all of the news reports and the stories, and it takes a special person to want to go into battle, to know, especially with Vietnam, which was the first televised war, the horrors that you're going to go into, but you want to serve this country and you want to go. It takes a special person to do that. So in my office, we have regular veterans meetings every month. I hope that we all, in our own way, doing everything we can to salute our veterans, to help them, to find ways to make sure that their quality of life is everything that they deserve to be. Most of the veterans I know, when they have come back to their communities, they are active in their communities in service ways. They're not looking for handouts. They're looking to try to be a real part of their community. So I want to salute all the veterans here. I want to thank you. I know that you're active in your communities also, and I would hope that we learn from them, because they're living examples of what people truly need to be, selfless, committed people that want to see a better country. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Montgomery on the resolution.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to thank Senator Brooks and Senator Harkin for this resolution and to join you in celebrating the men of greatness who are in our House today, and want to say that certainly, as part of what hopefully we're making up for the mistake that we made for not absolutely welcoming in a very big way the men and women who came back from Vietnam. I have a brother who was a Vietnam veteran, who is a Vietnam veteran, and I just remember I was not angry, because my brother, when he came home, it was the most wonderful, joyful thing for certainly me, but also certainly for sure my mother and my family, because we were happy that he was able to come home from Vietnam. So I didn't have the same experience of being angry. And I welcomed him home, and I welcome you here today. And I also thank the fact that I have in my district an organization which was one of the first, if not perhaps the first, organization of African-American veterans, especially Vietnam veterans, founded by Job Masariki, who was also a Vietnam veteran. So we share a lot in this room of very, very important and special regard for you, love for you, and thank you because you have given us an opportunity to talk about how great America has been, is, and to a very large extent because of what you were willing to give on our behalf. So thank you and God bless you.
Senator Jackson on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise in order to support my colleagues, Senator Harkin and Senator Brooks, in this resolution in honoring the veterans that are here today. Understanding that around the country, this is not only New York State, but this is Vietnam Veterans Day. I am not a veteran. I was in college when most of the activity was going on in the war, and my draft number was 128. And the last day of the draft, they reached up to, I believe, number 125. So I was happy that I was not called. I did not volunteer. And I don't know, quite frankly, if I would have volunteered. But I respect those that have served, those that have maybe been injured, and those that sacrificed their ultimate life on behalf of our country. One of the things that I've said, and I'm a newbie, I'm a new senator. I've only been in the Senate 3 months. And I said to my chief of staff, I want to make sure that at least one of my staff members is a veteran. And right now, that member came on board approximately a month ago. So I'm happy about that. And anything that I can do to help to support veterans who have served our country and sacrificed, I will do in order to help them who served our country. And I say to all of you, thank you for serving. Just like I am serving in a different capacity here in the New York State Senate, trying to do what's best for our state. So I thank you for your service, and I honor you this afternoon.
Senator Gonardis on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I can't match the eloquence that my colleagues have spoken about this resolution on behalf of our Vietnam veterans, especially Senators Harkin and Brooks. But I rise today because I want to dedicate my vote and my support of this resolution for one particular Vietnam veteran who had a profound impact on my life, and that is Mr. Jim. Mr. Jim, you see, was my scoutmaster, and he served two tours of duty in Vietnam at a very young age. And then when he returned back home, one of the first things he did was he started our Boy Scout troop. And he served as our scoutmaster for 40 plus years, graduated more than 50 Eagle Scouts from his ranks, myself being number 46. And I can stand here today without a hint of exaggeration or hyperbole and say, I would not be in this chamber today were it not for Mr. Jim and his leadership and his guidance and his mentorship and his ability to mold young boys into young men, all from lessons he learned during his service and that he instilled in us and imparted on us in his own deeply personal, deeply stoic, incredible way. He was a man of deep integrity. And, you know, Mr. Jim is no longer with us. We lost him about a year and a half ago. And like so many times, we never get a chance to say thank you. We never get a chance to say goodbye. And so I rise today to dedicate my vote to Mr. Jim, to thank him for what he has done for me. And I'm using you as the vehicle by which I can do that. So I want to thank you all for your service, for what you've done to this country, for what you've done for the people of this country, and for who you are and who you represent and the impact it's had on all of us, young and old. I'm a generation of the 9/11 generation. You know, the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq are the wars of my generation. And in my youthful precociousness, I didn't fully understand what it meant to go to war, what it meant to sacrifice. And Mr. Jim taught me, and Mr. Jim explained, and Mr. Jim opened my eyes. So I thank him for that, and I thank you for your service to our country.
Senator Lanza on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I also want to thank the sponsor for bringing this resolution to the floor. You know, the reason why we celebrate March 29th as Vietnam Veterans Day in New York is because of a man by the name of Lester Medelowitz, a Vietnam veteran from Staten Island, good friend to myself and Senator Savino. When I first arrived here in the Senate, Lester Medelowitz came to me with the idea of creating this day. After all, it was in 1973 on this day that President Nixon removed the last troops from Vietnam and signed an executive order that day making it Vietnam Recognition Day, but only for that year. And Lester thought, together with the Vietnam Veterans of America chapter on Staten Island, that we ought to recognize this day every year. And to me, it was a no-brainer. I mean, who would not agree with that idea? I brought the idea to Assemblyman Matt Tatone. He authored it in the Assembly. You would think within minutes it would have passed both houses. It didn't. That was just the beginning of a multi-year effort to convince folks across the political spectrum that it was time that we stand up and recognize the mistake that had been made and that which we owe the men and women who sacrificed in that conflict. People who opposed it said, Andrew, why do we need another day honoring veterans? After all, we have Veterans Day, we have Memorial Day, there are other opportunities throughout the year. Do we really need another day? My answer, of course, was absolutely, and here's why. Because something different happened to the Vietnam veterans. One of the shameful chapters in American history, when it has been pointed out here, they fought, they were sent, as Senator Sanders said, they were sent overseas to defend our liberty, and whether you agreed or not with the conflict, they did their duty. In fact, by the way, something you won't be taught in school, they never lost a single battle. Not a single battle was lost in Vietnam by the American men and women who went there to fight there. And so we said, we've got to right that wrong. And by righting the wrong, we do two things. We express our gratitude to them. We acknowledge wrong, but we also say to the world that we know when it's time to make amends. We know when it's time to address the things that we've done that shouldn't have happened, and to understand why they happened. A lot of factors that contributed to that, but clearly you had warped Hollywood actors and actresses, people in the media. You had phony politicians, you had a misguided public, all conspired to attack the very thing which we should honor most in America. And so they say, we've learned from it, but I'm here to tell you, we've got to remain vigilant, because those same ignorant, petty forces will continue to exist within human nature, unfortunately. So we did it here in New York. And then we worked with other states. Senator Savino and I and Assemblyman Tatone were contacted by another of legislative houses across America. And every single year, a couple of new states made this the law. We lobbied the federal government for 6 years to make it a national day of recognition, we were unsuccessful. But I'm happy to announce that on March 28, 2017, President Trump signed the Vietnam Veterans Recognition Act, which makes today a national day every year of recognition for Vietnam veterans. And it ought to be that way. 57,939 American soldiers' names are inscribed on that wall in Washington, D.C. Everyone here ought to go there and behold the sacrifice and the blood that was spilt on our behalf. So once again, as I do every year and every day, I want to say thank you, Vietnam veterans. Thank you for your sacrifices in defense of the greatest nation the world has ever known. The first nation on this earth conceived and founded upon the idea of individual liberty, which sits on the bedrock of freedom, the first ever. We've got to make sure that light never, never leaves this earth. And it will not, as long as there are men and women like the men and women we call Vietnam veterans. So I thank you on behalf of this body, on behalf of my state, and on behalf of this country. Thank you, and God bless you. And as Senator Brooks said, something wasn't said to you that should have been said then. And all these years later, we need to keep saying it, Senator Brooks. Welcome home, welcome home, welcome home.
Senator Savino on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. First, I want to completely associate myself with the comments of Senator Lanza, particularly with his recognition of our Staten Islander, Lester Mendelowitz, who helped make sure that the passage of the legislation here in New York State establishing a Vietnam Veterans Day. Lester is a proud Staten Islander and a Vietnam vet and a good friend. I want to thank also my colleagues for bringing this resolution to the floor, Senator Brooks and Senator Harkin, and all of my colleagues for the recognition of the Vietnam vets who are here. To you, I thank you for your service. And as I listened to Senator Brooks talk about the time frame of the years of the Vietnam War, I was much younger then. So I wasn't a teenager or a college student. I was in grammar school, and I remember there was a national campaign for younger kids. It was called the Vietnam Bracelet. We all wore one. It was a silver bracelet with the name of a Vietnam either veteran or POW or an MIA. And we all participated in praying for their recovery or for them to come home. Because we were looking at the Vietnam veterans somewhat differently than others. We saw them for what they were. They were fighting in a foreign land for the liberty and the defense of our nation. We didn't see it as a political effort. We saw them as soldiers that had been taken from their home to go somewhere else to defend America. That's how children saw it. That's how I see it to this day. To this day, Vietnam veterans still struggle with the way they were treated when they came home. And as Senator Lanza said and Senator Brooks said, every opportunity we have to apologize and to remind you that you are welcome home, we should do so. So whether it's an action taken here today, the National Day of Recognition, or standing up alongside of you every year when you remind us how many have still yet to come home. There are still roughly 1,350 prisoners of war in Vietnam that have yet to be accounted for. Several more, 1,500 or so, missing in action, who have not been found and returned home. And we should not rest until everyone who left here serving in the uniform of the United States is returned home in one way, shape, or form. And we know the Vietnam Veterans of America will not rest until that happens. And I personally want to thank Vietnam vets for their efforts over the last 2 years to help me convince the governor to do something that he didn't want to do in the beginning, to add post-traumatic stress disorder as a qualifying condition under the New York State
Compassionate Care Act, the medical marijuana law. It was somewhat controversial, I know, even within the veterans community. But many of you stepped forward and said you're still suffering 40 years beyond a war that ended. And you were willing to come forward and help change the law to make it easier for people who are suffering, recognizing that today's vets, the Iraq and Afghanistan vets, are as affected, sometimes even more so. So again, thank you for your service then. Thank you for your service to the community now, to veterans organizations. Welcome home, welcome home, welcome home. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Antonacci on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. Today's resolution brings back memories of my dad's service in the military. He was in the U.S. Navy, but also my mentor, my uncle, Tony Neshi. And Tony Neshi is now deceased, formulated the veterans memorials at the New York State Fair, on the New York State Fairgrounds, with the help of state government and others. I invite you to come to Syracuse during the New York State Fair. Veterans Day at the fair is the second Thursday. The first sausage sandwich is on me. It's about the only way I can really thank you other than to say thank you. But the ceremony that we conduct at exactly 11 a.m. is a wonderful ceremony. And as we say, all gave some gave all. And we also read a poem that talks about how the veteran has affected all of our lives. It is the veteran that gave us freedom of speech, freedom of religion, the ability to debate in this great hall. But I would love to have you come to Syracuse. The way we honor all veterans, and in particular Vietnam veterans, I think you'd be very pleased with. Thank you for your service.
Senator Ort on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise today, first of all, to thank Senator Harkin and Senator Brooks, my colleague on the Veterans Committee and the chair. But I rise from my own unique perspective as a combat veteran of a different conflict, the conflict in Afghanistan. And I think about what it was like when I came home. And I think about the reception at the airport. I think about going to my city council meeting and being welcomed back and being allowed to speak and being welcomed home in front of my fellow neighbors and residents and family members, marching in a parade. I think about getting my Thank a Vet card and being able to go to stores and get discounts and restaurants at Home Depot. And I think about, basically, it was you were like a rock star. And I think about the commercials on TV and the movies about veterans and just this feeling that veterans provided an invaluable service to our country. And they do. But I contrast that with how you came back. You weren't a hero. You were a baby killer. You weren't a hero. You were an enabler of a country and a system and an administration that many on the anti-war left crowd lumped in and attacked. You were a problem. And we didn't know how to deal with that problem when you came back home. I'm sure it was easy for some to forget the 57,000 plus Americans who died over there. And I think about, you know, every military funeral, a flag is presented to the family members. And it's presented with the words, on behalf of a grateful nation. How hollow those words must have rung to many of those families, because you returned to a nation that seemed anything but grateful for your service. Now, the good news today, I think, this gives me hope when you hear everyone talking, that we can learn from those past experiences. Not just feel bad, not just say we're sorry, but actually learn from that experience to take something away and make sure that it never happens again. And that, to me, is your great legacy that I want all of you to know, and every Vietnam veteran around the country to know, and in the New York State of New York to know, that your legacy to me is, for my generation of veterans, we got to come home to a very different welcome. We got to come home and to be a part of a country and a world that treats veterans and looks at our veterans very differently, because you have made a commitment that would never happen
to another generation of veterans again. And so on behalf of my generation of veterans, I say thank you not only for your service to our country, but thank you for what you have continued to do for veterans and to remind people that while you can oppose a war or a policy, you should never misconstrue that with the men and women who give their lives and put their lives on the line to defend this country. Because some of you volunteered, like I did, but some of you were drafted. And again, we want to remember those who didn't come back at all, that we could learn from their sacrifice and learn from this experience. So I thank you for your service. I thank the sponsors for the resolution. I thank all of my colleagues who have spoken today. And I say thank you. Welcome home. Mr. President, thank you.
Senator Gennaris on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. We often pause in this chamber to recognize the sacrifices of our veterans and to appreciate all that they've done for us. But the Vietnam veterans are special for many of the reasons we've already heard from many of my colleagues. Of course, the Vietnam War was the last time a draft was implemented in the United States, which means so many of our veterans served not necessarily by choice, but by a sense of obligation and duty to their country and a sense of service to the United States. And that service, unfortunately, was not recognized as it should have after it had concluded, as many have already indicated. And so we recognize, too, that the sacrifices made in the Vietnam War were not only lives lost or physical or mental health, but also a sacrifice of personal dignity so that the rest of us can learn how to do it right. And so as we heard Senator Ort say, how we now appreciate in a more appropriate way the service in the military of Americans, we have learned that lesson because of what all of you went through. And for that, I wanted to say that we appreciate you and all you have done to make the United States all it is, and I'm sure that future generations of veterans also thank you for suffering so that they could be appreciated appropriately. Thank you, Mr. President.
The resolution was previously adopted on March 26th. To our Vietnam veterans, I want to welcome you on behalf of the Senate. We, as you heard, we all thank you for your service to this country. We extend to you all the privileges and courtesies of this House. Welcome home. Please rise and be recognized. Senator Gennaris.
Mr. President, the request of Senator Harkin, that resolution is open for co-sponsorship.
The resolution is open for co-sponsorship. Should you choose not to be a co-sponsor of the resolution, please notify the desk. Senator Gennaris.
Can we now please take up Resolution 853 by Senator Thomas, read that resolution in its entirety, and recognize Senator Thomas.
The Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution Number 853 by Senator Thomas, celebrating holy and ancient Hindu spring festival. Whereas it is the sense of this legislative body, in keeping with its time-honored traditions, to recognize and pay tribute to those events which foster ethnic pride and enhance the profile of cultural diversity, which strengthens the fabric of communities of New York State. And whereas this legislative body is justly proud to celebrate holy, an ancient Hindu spring festival. And whereas Holi is an ancient Hindu spring festival, also known as the Festival of Colors, which celebrates fertility, color, love, and the triumph of good over evil. And whereas the festival signifies the coming of spring, the joy of friendship, and equality for all. And whereas the colored powders used in Holi represent love, happiness, and the freedom to live vibrantly, which are all principles shared and promoted by the Caribbean Equality Project. And whereas the origins of the festival can be found in various legends, in Hindu mythology, one of which tells the story of a demon, Holika, and her brother, King Hiranyakashipu. On the night before Holi, bonfires are lit to signify the burning of Holika and the victory of good over evil. And whereas this year, Holi begins on Wednesday, March 20th, and ends on Thursday, March 21st. The timing of Holi depends on the moon, meaning the date of the event can vary, although it usually occurs in March to mark the end of winter. And whereas it is the intent of this legislative body to recognize and commend events which symbolize the historical, social, and cultural development of this great state and embody the spirit of the principles upon which this nation was founded. Therefore be it resolved that this legislative body pause in its deliberations to celebrate Holi, an ancient Hindu spring festival.
Senator Thomas on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to celebrate the Festival of Holi as a member of the most diverse class of senators in this chamber at any point in New York history. I'm also fully aware, as an immigrant, I owe a lot to these veterans here for what they have done to fight for me and for me to stand here to celebrate a festival that happens thousands of miles away. Now let's get back to Holi. Holi ke sab avasa pe aapko subko mera aur mera parivar ke taraf se rang badi shubh kamne. That basically means I wish you all a happy Holi from me and my family. And we have special guests with us in our chamber for my community to celebrate with us all. Holi is one of the great festivals of India, which is celebrated with great zeal, zest, and enthusiasm. It is also called the Festival of Colors, during which people play with colors and splash colors on each other. You may have seen this in your own constituencies and wondered what it means. This isn't a religious festival. Instead, it marks the start of spring. It is also a festival of compromise. This is the day when someone you may have disagreed with in the past year comes to you, throws some colors on you, hugs you, and you all become friends. As part of this festival today, I wanted to come around to my Republican colleagues, throw some colors, and put my arms around you to become friends, but I was advised against it. Maybe next time. Holi is also a festival of harmony where friends and relatives get together in the evening or visit their friends, family, and neighbors and greet them with colors and sweets. The mouth-watering delicacies of Holi, like laddus, add a flavor to the season of festivity. Don't worry, senators and staff, everyone in this chamber gets a laddu today to celebrate with us. People hug each other on Holi and give a new beginning by forgetting all the hatreds and sorrows. As we take part in another yearly tradition called the New York State Budget, where we are sure to have many disagreements, let us take a moment today to be kind to those who disagree with us, give them a hug, and eat a laddu. Thank you.
Senator Sanders on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. As the proud senator of Southeast Queens, I actually have the largest Indo-Caribbean community, Richmond Hill and South Ozone Park, so I'm very familiar. One of the things I was not familiar with was that you see the suit, this is not what you go to the holiday in. I quickly learned to my dismay and to my dry cleaner's joy that this is the worst and last thing that you go. I can only tell you that I never knew there were that many colors in the world because my suit had every single color. There was not an area of my suit that was not colored. I must admit that I'm not even sure if I was able to wear it ever again. So if anyone wants to partake in such a holiday, can I assure you, you do not want to wear your Sunday go to meeting clothes. But the holiday is for good spirits, and when people were throwing powder on me, I might not have had the best spirits, I confess, but then they would hug me. This was alarming. I didn't know what to do. What do you do in a case like that? After, I guess, the 12th powdering, I got into the spirit of it and said, the suit is gone, let me just enjoy the moment. So I have encouraged everyone. In fact, if you want to participate in
with it on Sunday. We're doing it in South Ozone Park. And I encourage you to all come out. But I would not wear those beautiful shoes and that nice tie. I would come a little different. So I'm glad that my friends and neighbors are here. I'm glad that we are showing more customs. This is a part of a beautiful mosaic that is America, a beautiful thing that we're bringing in more customs and holidays from all over and excellent people from all over. So in the spirit of the season, I want to say thank you for all that you have brought up here. I'll even forgive you for the suit that I can never wear again, but I look forward to being out there. And this time, I want to throw the chalk first. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Prasad on the resolution.
Thank you, Ms. I rise today to thank Senator Thomas for bringing this resolution to the floor. And you may wonder, why is she rising to speak on Holi? I am someone who has celebrated Holi for my entire life, or as we call it in Guyana, Pagua. So to everyone, happy Pagua. Happy Holi, happy Pagua. And as Senator Sanders has said, if you have not experienced it, I encourage everyone to experience it just once in your life. I remember going to Amsterdam one year, and my mother and I are walking, and I hear this noise, and I'm like, what is that? What are they doing? So we go around the corner, and lo and behold, they were celebrating Holi. And what did I do? In Amsterdam, the streets of Amsterdam, I celebrated. That's what it's about. It's about fun. It's about eliminating all the negative from your life and participating in something that's bringing joy to us. So to everyone again, happy Holi, happy Pagua, and let's celebrate the joys in our lives. Thank you all very much.
Senator Comrie on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to thank Senator Thomas for bringing this resolution to enlightening this chamber about the joys of Holi, which is, or Pagua, which is also known as a festival of love. Members keep claiming they have the most whatever in their districts. You know? But I want to claim that I have a good representation also in my district. And I want to share Senator Sanders' example, because I went in a suit and tie to the first Holi festival, and they were waiting for me. So, and you know, I'm an easy target, so it was, but it was a lot of fun. And you know, one thing that's great about this country is that when people come here and they're showing us what their history is, what their religions are, you know, what their traditions are, and that they can celebrate it in here in New York in a positive way, that they can pass those traditions on to their children, that their children can see living examples of it happening within the community, and that we can all embrace it, is another testament to the men who were just here that fought to preserve this country so that people can now come here and celebrate their traditions as well. So happy Holi, happy Pagua, and I'm just glad that we can do these types of things in a country that embraces diversity. Thank you, Mr. President.
The question is on the resolution. All in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed? The resolution is adopted. To our guests, I welcome you on behalf of the Senate. We extend to you the courtesies and privileges of this House. Please rise and be recognized. Senator Janaris.
Mr. President, Senator Thomas would like to open this resolution for co-sponsorship.
Resolution is open for co-sponsorship. Should you choose not to be a co-sponsor of the resolution, please notify the desk. Senator Janaris.
Can we now call up previously adopted Resolution 678 by Senator Ramos?
Order in the chamber, please. Order in the chamber, please. Senator Janaris.
Sorry, Mr. President. Previously adopted Resolution 678 by Senator Ramos. Read its title only and recognize Senator Ramos.
The Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution number 678 by Senator Ramos, memorializing Governor Andrew M. Cuomo to proclaim March 31st, 2019 as Cesar Chavez Day in the state of New York.
Senator Ramos on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. We do not have any federal holidays that celebrate American Latinos in this country, despite our numerous contributions since its inception. Growing up Latino in this country is hard. We rarely see our heroes in textbooks, and we often see ourselves and our parents denigrated in the news. We are rarely given the opportunity to celebrate who we are and tell our own stories. It is more important than ever that we uplift those who have fought against the system of supremacy that has colonized us, enslaved us, tried to erase us from history, and continues to exploit our labor every time there is a chance. I'm proud to say that in this chamber, that ends today. Mr. President, I rise to celebrate one of the greatest Americans to have ever lived. As we hear in the resolution, Cesar Chavez worked tirelessly to organize farm workers using nonviolent tactics to have their work appropriately compensated and their human rights recognized. That journey began many decades ago, and his work isn't finished. As more Latino Americans begin to fill the halls of legislative bodies across the country and in this state, we bring with us our life experiences, but most importantly, the innumerable sacrifices of our parents and our ancestors, who often come from countries that were pillaged, only to come to this country to be pillaged again every day. It is our duty to ensure that our hardships are not endured by future generations. In New York, there is a Jim Crow era law still on our books that denies human beings, mostly Black and Latino taxpaying New Yorkers, parity with nearly every other worker in this state. Farm workers in New York State do not have the right to a day off, or unemployment benefits, or overtime pay, or the right to collectively bargain, and that must change once and for all. We know that the agricultural industry, mostly family farms, have their challenges, especially as corporations increasingly exert their political influence to take over the industry and even as consumer preferences change. As I've begun to tour upstate New York, I have met farmers who are good employers out of their own volition, and I have met farm workers whose living quarters are on the orchards they work, meaning they breathe in pesticides day in and day out. I have heard stories of women farm workers raising their voices against disparities in pay, only to be fired for standing up for themselves. I have met men and women who toil relentlessly for the profit of others without much to show for themselves. In fact, I asked one of the women I met what her plan for retirement was. She laughed at me, and she told me you only leave farm work in very, very old age if you're sick or you're dead. Viejo, enfermo, o muerto. This is New York in 2019. We can do better. The fate of a worker's quality of life should not be left to the fortune of finding a good employer. No human being is disposable. Their rights must be codified like everyone else's. We can pass the Farm Worker Fair Labor Practices Act this session. We'll be holding hearings across the state on the subject so we can hear from every stakeholder. And I'd like to thank my colleagues, Senators Metzger, May, and Martinez, for working with me. It is always the right time to do the right thing. It is always the right time to recognize the humanity in others. It is always right to grant people the respect and the dignity that they inherently deserve. As Cesar Chavez said himself, we draw our strength from the very despair in which we have been forced to live. We shall endure. Si se puede.
Senator Sanders on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. The Bible teaches us that we're going to be judged not by how many important friends we have or who's strong and who's rich, but what have we done for the least among us? And Cesar Chavez is a person who stood out for doing for the least among us, taking his life on the line over and over to help organize folk who everyone had seemingly turned their backs on. Now, this means a little something to me more than most because my father was a sharecropper. I come from this group of people, just as good as anybody else, with needs the opportunities of everyone else. So absolutely, we can't stop until we find the last person in New York that doesn't have equality of opportunity. It doesn't have the opportunities. And if these are the farm workers, then we need to turn our attention immediately to addressing this situation. Let's address it in a way that doesn't have the farms go out of business. But I believe that there is a way that we can find a way that everybody wants to ensure the equality of opportunity, which is the thing that makes America great, if we can ever get to it. So having said those things, again, I want to thank you for bringing this to the floor. We must always continue to fight and remember that an injury to one is an insult to all of us, that we can't just say that we can turn our backs on them and we'll eat the food, but we won't think about who's picking the food and getting the food to us. That's a foolish thing to do, especially if they're getting sick in your food. Not a good thing. Let's do something about this. Thank you for Chavez bringing the resolution, and thank him for looking out for all of us. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Senator Jackson on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. My colleagues, I rise in order to support the resolution put forward by our colleague Jessica Ramos, honoring Cesar Chavez. His birthday is 2 days from now, March 31st. And also in support of the bill that is sponsored by her, in which I am a co-sponsor, dealing with the farm workers in New York State, making sure that they have the opportunity to have a day's rest, making sure that they have the opportunity to receive overtime and a fair wage, and making sure that the opportunity that they, like other state employees, have an opportunity to join a union. That's what it's about, basic respect and dignity for all. I've said this before, and some people don't like the analogy, even machines have to take a break, or else they burn out. And we're talking about not machines, we're talking about human beings that have families, that have issues and concerns with their health mentally and physically. And so I stand today in support of honoring Cesar Chavez for what he's done in order to bring respect and dignity to farm workers across not only our country but the world, in order to move forward and support the bill that's in front of us, that's been in front of both the Assembly and Senate for years, and hopefully, God willing, we'll be able to move it this year and pass it into law. Thank you.
The resolution was previously adopted on March 14th. Senator Janaris.
Senator Ramos would like to open up that resolution for co-sponsorship, Mr. President.
The resolution is open for co-sponsorship. Should you choose not to be a co-sponsor of the resolution, please notify the desk. Senator Janaris.
Can we now take up the reading of the calendar?
The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 66, Senate Print 783A by Senator Breslin, Act to amend the Economic Development Law.
The bill is high and will be laid aside for the day.
Calendar number 328, Senate Print 41 by Senator Hoylman, an act to amend the General Business Law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 60th day after it shall have become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Finnegan, Janaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Senator Hoylman to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to speak about this bill, to explain that this legislation would give courts the discretion to order some portion up to the full amount of statutory fines or civil penalties for state antitrust crimes to go to the Office of Victim Services. So that means that fines that are accrued in court over antitrust crimes can be used for the victims of domestic violence, for medical expenses, funeral expenses, loss of earnings or support, counseling costs, crime scene cleanups, the cost of domestic violence shelters, loss of property, and attorney's fees. And I'm very grateful to my assembly sponsor, Assemblymember Engelbreit, for carrying this legislation since the early 1990s and pushing forward in a way that allowed its passage in the other house. Unfortunately, it has never been brought to the floor here. in the Senate, even though it was 36 years ago, Mr. President, that a judge attempted to use civil penalties from a white-collar crime to go to the Office of Victim Services. Well, today we're correcting that with this legislation, and no longer will we be blocking an attempt to help victims through the Office of Victim Services. I vote aye. Thank you, Mr. President.
Announce the results.
In relation to count number 328, those senators recorded in the negative are Senators Amador, Antonacci, Jacobs, Jordan, and O'Mara. Ayes 55, nays 5.
The bill is passed.
Counter number 329, Senate Print 745A by Senator Montgomery, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Fennin, Janaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Senator Montgomery to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to just thank the leaders and my colleagues for bringing forth this legislation. It's very important for so many of us. Many of my colleagues, especially members on both sides of the aisle, especially Republicans, have asked for their waterways to be designated as inland waterways for the express purpose of being eligible to participate in the program that this bill represents. And so this legislation would allow for community boards in the city of New York to also be eligible to participate in this program. It allows for local communities to receive a grant that the state provides to help them with funding for planning for what should happen on the waterways in their communities. And so with this, New York City will be eligible, along with the other communities around the state of New York, to participate. Those of us who represent community boards with waterfront land, and several of us do in the city of New York, our community boards, which is the citizens of the city who are looking to participate in the planning for their own communities, the state would now be able to assist them in doing that. So I want to thank you, and I look forward to this legislation becoming law this session. Thank you.
Senator Montgomery to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar number 329, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Akshar, Amador, Antonacci, Boyle, Funke, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Jordan, Little, O'Mara, Ort, Ranzenhofer, Robach, Serino, Seward, and Tedesco. Ayes 43, nays 17.
The bill is passed.
Counter number 332, Senate Print 1403 by Senator Carlucci, an act to amend the general business law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Fennin, Janaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar number 332, those senators voting in the negative are Senators Akshar, Amador, Antonacci, Boyle, Flanagan, Funky, Gallivan, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Lanza, Laval, Little, O'Mara, Ort, Ranzenhofer, Robach, Seward, and Tedesco. Ayes 41, nays 19.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 345, Senate Print 3537 by Senator Carlucci, an act to amend the tax law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adalo, Flanagan, Janaris, Kruger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
Ayes 60.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 352, Senate Print 4543 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
Section 7, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adabo, Flanagan, Janaris, Kruger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Senator Metzger to explain her vote.
I want to thank Senator Parker for introducing this legislation. If we want a better world for our kids and for their kids, we have to address climate change. And this is a great way for the state to take steps in modeling where we have to go. I drive an electric car, a Chevy Bolt. I have a huge district that I get around, but it's not just about electric cars. It's about changing the way we do things, carpooling, telecommuting. There are various changes that we have to make, but the fact is that transportation accounts for 42% of our greenhouse gas emissions, and we've got to reduce those if we're going to address this threat. Thank you very much.
Senator Metzger, we recorded in the affirmative. Senator Little to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I certainly believe in a lot of the conservation measures that Senator Metzger was speaking of. But when I look at this bill and I think about my district, I don't see anything in here that accounts for rural areas. And my fear, when it talks about limiting the number of miles state workers could drive or limiting the number of vehicles that state workers would have, I only can think about the mileage that state workers need. Think of the comptroller's office and audits that they're doing in the small towns in the vast area. My Senate district alone is 6,400 square miles. I think education and working with people is the best way to do it, but not through this. My fear is that there would be limitations on what could be done. We don't have subways. We have limited bus service. And we have great distances, so therefore I vote no.
Senator Little to be recorded in the negative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar number 352, those senators voting in the negative are Senators Akshar, Antonacci, Funky, Griffo, Jordan, Lanza, Little, O'Mara, Ort, and Ranzenhofer. Also Senator Tedesco. Ayes 49, nays 11.
Bill is passed. Senator Janaris, that completes the reading of today's calendar.
Mr. President, is there any further business at the desk?
There is no further business at the desk.
There will be an immediate Democratic conference after session, and I move to adjourn until Sunday, March 31st at 10 a.m., intervening days being legislative days.
There is an immediate meeting of the Democratic conference, and on motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Sunday, March 31st at
10 a.m.
Intervening
days being legislative
days.